Hi everyone, in this video, I'm going to simplify the basic understanding of some of the 5G main features and parameters. I will also explain how to refine the feature functionality from traces and field testing. Okay, the first part here, that this is today's agenda, we are going to cover those four features. So moving forward, the first feature here, it will be about Uplink 256 QAM. As you know that Uplink 256 QAM is transferring 8 bits per symbol, compared to 64 QAM, it's providing around 33% improvement in the uplink peak throughput, maximum throughput, because before 64 QAM is transferring 6 bits per symbol. Okay, first of all, that uplink 256 QAM will take over in the very near center, which users have a very good radio condition, very good SNR and so on. So once you activate the feature, you need to verify the field testing whether it's work or not. Not only based on the maximum speed and so on, but just to confirm from the traces and from the field testing. So the first part you need to do, you need to go and check your UE capability, whether your test device is supporting uplink 256 QAM or not. So this message, you will find it in the UE capability message. It's called PUSCH 256 QAM. If it's supported, then you can continue your testing. Then once you start the testing, you're supposed to receive RRC configuration message from the init B, and you'll find that under BUCH configuration setup, you can find that MCS table 256 QAM has been delivered to the UE. This means now the feature is working and you can start doing your testing. And the last part, for sure, you can verify from the related counters whether the counters start like picking or not, or start counting and so on. So moving forward, this is the 3GBP tables for comparison between 64 QAM and 256 QAM. The first part, as you can see here, that all starting from 23 MCS till 28, it was transmitting 6 bits, even before this, 21. Here now, the range from 23 till 28 has been replaced by the 256 QAM, which is 8 bits per symbol. This is if you want like to change the 3GBP table as well as for confirmation. So this table is supposed to be delivered, as mentioned, the RRC reconfiguration message to the UE. Moving forward for the next feature, which is one of the very good feature as well, BUCH waveform adaptation. As you know, in 5G, currently in BUCH waveform is supporting two modes, right? The first one is a cycle prefixed orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, CBO of DM. And this part, this is by default, this one is working. As you know, the resource allocation for BUCH, the resource allocation can be contiguous or continuous on continuous or non-continuous. It's like very flexible. That it's characterized by the flexibility or flexible resource allocation compared especially for the next type. Secondly, it can transfer up to full layers, and this is for sure depending on the UE capability. For example, if you can support two rank two, then it can take up to rank two. But the main drawbacks of this one, it's having a high BAPR, which is a peak average ratio, right? Peak average power ratio. And for this part, this is more recommended in the new cell center. So actually this part now, as I told you, by default, this only this one is working. DFTS COVDM is not working. So in case you are going to activate DFTS COVDM, that it will give you some benefits in the coverage, because this one, first, the first drawbacks is just looking for the contiguous or continuous resources. It cannot like having a non-continuous resource allocation. And for because of this, it's reducing the power. And because of the peak average to power ratio has been increased, this can improve the cell edge users by around 2 dB coverage gain. And this value, I found it in the 3GBP. So once you activate the feature, you need to confirm whether it's working, taking effect or not. Maybe it will not be affected from the KPIs, or you just need to confirm from the field testing and so on, and in addition to the KPIs for sure. So the first part, the adaptation will be based on what? Based on the BUCH SNR. Uplink SNR, which is the B for BUCH channel. So assuming now they have a user at the cell center, so he would be using by default CBO of DM. So because he like assuming that he have a very good quality. Once this user is being moved to the edge of the cell, his radio condition will start to deteriorate, right? And maybe the SNR will be very bad. In this case, the GNB will instruct the user to switch to DFT SCO of DM, if you're assuming this feature is working. And this is what you are going to receive. you are going to receive this one under the initial uplink bandwidth part. There will be switching indication from the RS reconfiguration message. This like code transform recorder. This one, if it's enabled, this means DFT SAVM now is, will take effect, and the user will be starting using DFT single carrier OFDM. And if it's disabled, this means the user is still using CB OFDM. So once it's confirmed it's being enabled, then the user will start using this one, and we are expecting that his coverage will be improved. But the main point which I need to highlight for you here, that not all users, there are some users have compatibility issue which you're not supporting this part, and this can cause some KPI deterioration or address. So be very careful whenever you are going to go to check this feature. Moving forward, it's about the third feature. It's about the downlink beamforming allocation based on SRS base. As you know, that currently majority is working with the CSIRS, the beam calculation. Downlink beamforming is being calculated based on CSIRS. The unit B, GNUT B, sorry, is being transferring CSIRS, and the users will start measuring the CRS. Then it will be reporting the BMI report, including the rank indication and so on. And based on this feedback, the unit B will make the weightage calculation, and it will decide the beams for each user as shown here. However, as you know, that in TDD system, we have this concept of a channel reciprocity. A channel reciprocity means that the downlink and uplink, the TDD is using the same frequency for uplink and downlink. This means we can use uplink feedback to estimate the downlink channel propagation, which now the SRS will take a place here or take like can take over in this case. So in this case, if you have the in your network, if you have the probability or you can enable the SRS feedback, it can give you some gain, and I will explain in the next slides from where the gain can come. Okay, moving forward, the question here, why we are expecting some gain in the downlink performance if you use downlink beamforming based on SRS base or based on the SRS feedback? Okay, I believe that the main reason for this part that, as you know, that SRS is being transmitted periodically, almost like it's most of the time it's being transmitted by the UE. So in this case, the GNUB can have a timely update about the channel propagation, downlink channel propagation, so it can make the weight calculation, so they can give more accuracy for the weight calculation and the downlink beamforming assignment for the specific or for the particular user which is sending the SRS. This is the first point. Second point, it can be also that SRS is being transmitted through the full bandwidth, so that also still the GNUB can have a precise feedback about the complete bandwidth, so it can also can give more accuracy for the downlink beamform, for the weight calculation and downlink form assignment. Okay, so compared to SRS weight, to BMI weight or CSIRS, as you know here, the first point here, that first part, before doing the weight calculation, the GNUB should transmit the CSIRS, then the user will start making the channel estimation, channel quality estimation for the downlink, then it will send the feedback to the GNUB through BMI, rank indication, CQI. Then the GNUB will start the weight calculation, and now it will start making the downlink beamforming direction and so on towards the UEs. So the main point that in some cases, your feedback or your downlink estimation might change during this kind of report. So this means that in some particular cases, the measurement or the weight calculation maybe will not be that 100% accurate. This can impact your beamforming weight calculation. So this is one of the advantage of the SRS compared to the BMI. Okay, but the main point here, it's not necessary that SRS weight would give all the time compared to BMI weight. Actually, it's recommended or it's known that SRS is giving better performance need to the cell center. While BMI or BMI weight or CSIRS beam weight or code book is giving in the cell edge users. Okay, why this can be the reason? Okay, as you know that if the user move to the edge, still he can get better coverage compared to the uplink. So this means in this case, the feedback of the SRS will not be that accurate compared to the CSIRS because of the weak coverage. The SRS is getting very weak as long as it's moving to cell edge. So it's recommended in this case to use CSIRS. That's why you have this kind of adaptation. The GNUB can change from SRS to CSRS and vice versa based on the SRS uplink SNR. If the SNR uplink SNR is good, it will keep the user the beam calculation weight calculation based on the SRS. If it's bad, it will be starting now using the codebook or CSIRS and so on. This kind of thresholds is uplink. It's like predefined or configured. You can check it in your network or you can check it based on your vendor and so on. It's just to take what is the current value. Okay, the main question here: how to verify this feature of the field and how? And what is the kind of process or recommended test scenario? Okay, the recommended test scenario before going through how to verify it, that you need to do static testing for the near and edge users, as you can see here, for example, near and edge, and make like a lot, many speed tests or download and so on, just to confirm your testing. This is just to make the comparison between both of them. Then you can also make mobility testing just to confirm what is the condition of mobility and so on. But before starting the test, you need to first confirm that whether the UE is supporting the SRS or not. It's called actually antenna switching. Antenna switching can be checked from this part, from the UE capability, something called supported SRS TX port switch. In case if you have less number of transmitter compared to the receiver for the UE, so in this case, you need to support antenna switching and it should be showing like this. If this one showing not supported or not available at all and the UE capability, this giving indication that the UE is not supporting SRS. So in this case, you need to check another device just to confirm your testing and so on. Okay, once you have confirmed this one verification, once you go to the testing, you just to confirm the current stage or what is the current being used usage. What it means by usage is under something called SRS resource set. This is indicating what SRS is used for what. You have four types. I will be explaining this one in different video regarding the SRS, but just to give you a brief about it, you have the antenna switching. Antenna switching means that you have SRS downlink based beamforming. SRS is used for SRS downlink based beamforming. If it's codebook, this means the CSIRS. This means now your beamforming calculation is based on CSIRS. So you just need to go and check this message. It's under our serial configuration message. You can find us under SRS resource set. You will find usage. And this should be changing whenever you're moving from the cell to edge and vice versa. This is how you can confirm your testing. And the last part we are going to discuss now, it's about the signal radio BR3. Signal radio BR3 actually is optional. It's not currently enabled. Majority of the signaling is being transferred through the SRB1, signal radio BR1, as shown here, that all the, these kind of three messages, RRC configuration, complete, and measurement report, is being going through the SRB1, transferring from 5G UE to master NB. Then the master NB can transfer it through to the SG NB and so on. So why it's recommended, or why we can do a trial to enable the SRB3? This can give some advantage or some improvement in the latency, because this will save some timing, and instead of having this kind of exchange or transferring from the 4G then to going to 5G, you can now have a direct communication once you enable the SRB3 between the 5G and the SG NB, as you can see here. So this all these three messages would be direct transferred from the 5G UE device to the SG NB, which is RRC configuration, coefficient complete, and measurement report. And this is just one example, quick example for the signaling comparison. Assuming, for example, you have SG NB modification procedures ongoing. So the first part, the UE will be reporting the measurement report to the NB, then NB will transfer it to the GNB through RRC transfer. Then GNB will ask the NB to make a SG NB modification. Then now the NB will forward this request to the UE through RRC confirm message. Then there would come the reply and so on. And here you should be having SG NB modification confirmed from the NB to the GNB. Now, once you enable the SRB3, as you can see here now, the UE can have a direct communication with the GNB, which can save some time instead of having this kind of exchange between NB and GNB. You can now have a direct communication. So this part expecting to have some reduction in the latency for the signaling, RRC signaling and so on. And one more point to highlight, that not all the devices are supporting SRB3. Some of the devices not supporting, but in all cases, even if it's not supporting, it still will go through the normal process, which is will be going through SRB1. And that's it for today's video. Please, if you like the video, subscribe to the channel and drop a comment and like and share it with your friends. See you next video.